Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Riders Come Out at Night, Brutality, Corruption, and Cover-Up in Oakland by Ollie Winston and Darwin BondGraham. Read by Robin Miles.
To our parents. Prologue. American law enforcement is broken. Local and state governments spend more than $100 billion annually to operate 18,000 police and sheriff's departments, yet crime remains an intractable problem. Millions of people are arrested each year, filling the world's largest network of prisons and jails, but meaningful rehabilitation has never been achieved. Even when this system operates optimally, when police abide by the letter and spirit of constitutional law, it still produces disturbingly unequal outcomes. Black communities, in particular, have been harmed by policing since the dawn of the institution. Corruption, brutality, secrecy, and racism have always shaped policing. Because of the inordinate power bestowed on law enforcement, these abuses cause immense damage to society. This is why tens of millions of Americans and people around the world marched in the streets in the summer of 2020 amidst a global pandemic to call for an end to police killings of Black people and a reimagining of public safety. The street demonstrations following the murder of George Floyd, a 46-year-old Black man whose neck was knelt on by a Minneapolis police officer for over 8 minutes because he was suspected of buying cigarettes with a counterfeit $20 bill, were estimated to be the largest in the nation's history. Without a doubt, Americans want fundamental change, but can policing be fixed? Since the mid-1990s, the primary tool to reform law enforcement has been the consent decree, a court-enforced agreement requiring a police department to overhaul itself under the supervision of external monitors. This legalistic mechanism, authorized by Congress in the wake of the outrage over Rodney King's beating by Los Angeles cops in 1991 and the devastating riots following their acquittal a year later, focuses on reducing uses of force, police shootings, racial profiling, chokeholds, and more. The results have been distinctly mixed. Some of the first consent decrees in cities such as Pittsburgh, 1997, Washington, D.C., 2001, and Cincinnati, 2001, showed promise by changing long-held police practices and reducing police shootings. More recent interventions in cities like Portland, Oregon, 2015, Albuquerque, 2015, Ferguson, Missouri, 2016, Baltimore, 2017, and Chicago, 2019, came on the heels of controversial police killings and verified the lived experiences of over-policed communities by revealing the multitude of ways that law enforcement systematically abuses the poor. But ask residents of these cities if they would consider their police forces fixed, and many will tell you that real change remains to be seen. These cities and others have struggled with violent, bigoted, unaccountable police whose behavior is often sheltered, protected, and even condoned by police brass, local politicians, prosecutors, and judges. When reforms do happen, they are rarely incorporated into an agency's culture, which is often driven by a reactionary ethos passed down through generations of rank-and-file cops. Most of the dozens of consent decrees pursued by the U.S. Department of Justice ran their course in just a few years. Policies were rewritten, officers retrained, and the monitors packed up and left. Resistance to change imposed from outsiders, especially civilians, is baked into police culture in the United States. Backsliding is commonplace. New abuses constantly surface. Outside the halls of government, policing has been challenged by protest movements against law enforcement corruption and brutality. Led by those most impacted, including Black, Latino, and LGBTQ communities, most major cities have seen sustained campaigns demanding change. At times, these have taken the form of riots, the language of the unheard, as per Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The Los Angeles neighborhood of Watts exploded in 1965, Detroit in 1967, San Francisco in 1979. Miami burned in 1980, Los Angeles in 1992, Cincinnati erupted in 2001. The more recent flare-ups in Ferguson and Minneapolis are only two of the latest examples of the thousands of rebellions against police abuses in small towns and big cities since the mid-1960s. More often, community resistance to police violence is less explosive, involving grueling campaigns by grassroots activists advancing demands such as the prosecution of violent officers, stripping departments of militarized weapons, and the establishment of strong civilian oversight boards. Still, the police remain unreformed. Each year, new scandals erupt in cities large and small, exposing more than just a few bad apples. A rotten system continues to degrade the U.S. Constitution by brutalizing and abusing marginalized communities. The stakes are incredibly high. Although many Americans still believe the police are necessary to defend life and property and to apprehend violators of the law, confidence in law enforcement dropped to a record low of 48% in 2020. The crisis of policing is a crisis of governmental legitimacy, and the results of this crisis are the ruined lives of victims of police brutality and corruption, and the intractable public safety problems that police can never solve on their own. The city of Oakland is the edge case in American law enforcement, its police department having been placed under court oversight since 2003. More has been done to try to reform the Oakland Police Department than any other police force in the United States. The saga of Oakland and its scandal-plagued police department illustrates the still unfulfilled promise of reforming law enforcement. The OPD is by no means the only corrupt or brutal law enforcement agency in the country. But because of unflinching efforts by local activists, attorneys, the courts, and a few brave whistleblowers, more of the Oakland Police Department's secrets, failures, and scandals have finally been exposed. This is the story of one police department and one city, but it's also a history of American policing and a look at where it's headed. The collective experiences of these Oaklanders, from a wide-eyed rookie cop realizing the depth of his superior's sadistic behavior, to two attorneys hell-bent on seeing reform implemented despite obstacles thrown their way by a rotating cast of obstinate police chiefs and politicians, to the countless innocent victims of police brutality, hold parallels for other communities that have struggled to rein in the coercive arm of the state. 1. Dogwatch, Ghost Town. Nobody really knows how Ghost Town got its name, but the moniker fits. Walled off from most of Oakland by freeways on its northern and eastern borders and warehouses to the west, Ghost Town, known formerly as the Hoover Foster neighborhood, has been haunted since the mid-20th century by the combined forces of racism, deindustrialization, and chronic unemployment. It was always a working-class community, but for most of its existence, Ghost Town residents could find decent-paying jobs on the East Bay's burgeoning industrial waterfront. That changed starting in the 1950s, as factories closed and Oakland's economy descended into a multi-decade decline. White residents left the neighborhood and much of the rest of Oakland for the prosperity of expanding suburbs such as Pleasanton and Walnut Creek. Downtown Oakland's once bustling commercial corridors on both Broadway and Telegraph Avenue began emptying out in the 1970s with the closures of major department stores. At one point, a high proportion of houses and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.